Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada and certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach according to the true and correct name and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word, our Son, is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifest in our physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there is Lord's me and God's me. But we now know each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, or the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language since some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such things as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on his chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word, our Son. A superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth frame as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world called Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons of children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. I watch for his peace, and I slowly and speak the truth. We have a prayer this morning by Dr. Lori Lawless, a selection of music, and a scripture lesson by Dr. LeBron Harden.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Let us all bow our hearts and minds in prayer. Heavenly Father Yahweh, we thank you once again for allowing us to be here and to sit and to learn more and more about your purpose and plan of salvation. We also ask that those that are listening in on the broadcast and those that are still out there and wondering what's really going on, well, this is the place. And I'm not talking about this building, I'm talking about this tabernacle or this temple within one man's mankind. All these things we ask in your only begotten Son's name, Yahshua Messiah, let us all say.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon.
Good morning.
Morning? Is it still morning?
Okay. Bad.
Good morning. Good morning.
Yeah. Still on European time.
Yeah, I'm still on. that's the truth. Today I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer of the Scripture Research Association, and reprinted by Yahshua Promotions. I'll be reading Hebrews, the 8th chapter, which can be found in the back of the Holy Name Bible on page 294. Now, of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which Yahweh pitched and not man. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices. Wherefore, it is of necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer. For if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with it, he said, Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith Yahweh. For it is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my laws in their mind, I will write them in their hearts, and I will be to them their Elohim, and they shall be to me my people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor, and every man his brother, saying, Know ye Yahweh. For all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to thy neighbors, to their unrighteousness. Sorry, where I got that from. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that he saith, A new covenant he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxes old is ready to vanish away. I have read Hebrews 8 chapter. Let us all say.
Hallelujah.
This Sunday, we will continue with our winter series of lectures, and our first speaker will be Dr. Nisha Imri.
Nisha.
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 Hey. Say it, boy. They get more than name, boy. You say Yahweh any kind of way you want, but you better say my name right. I ain't got no teeth. I do the best I can. Nisha, right? I'm going to practice that. Nisha. Let me go get you for that. There you go. Okay. Okay, pull it out from your mouth. Okay. Do your thing, baby.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to share with you what I've come to learn and understand about the principle of 40, according to the pattern. Okay, can I get John 101?
John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made.
That's good. So Yahweh is the unity, and Yahweh is Spirit. And He took on shape and form as Elohim, which is divine wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength, before taking on form in the flesh and the shape of a man as Yahshua the Messiah. And great 1 John 5:7.
First John 5:7. For there are three which bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree as one.
That's good. So Yahweh is a pattern. And I want to get to the principle of 4, but I want to get to that by going through the steps in the tabernacle pattern. So first you have the gate, and you have the brazen altar of sin sacrifice, which is the second step. The gate's the first step. The third step would be the brazen laver, and the fourth step is the door. That is the first veil. Did you get John 10:9?
John 10:9. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture.
So yeah, that's good. Thank you. Yahweh is the door, and that is shown here in the fourth step of the tabernacle. Then you got the holy place, which is the fifth step. The sixth step is the second veil, and the seventh step is the most holy place. And let's see. All right, I'm going to need Exodus 24:16.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days, colon. And the seventh day He called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mount in the eyes of the children of Israel. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights.
Okay. So Moses was in that cloud for 40 days. And in his vision, He was shown the creation for 7 days.
That's right.
And the remainder of the time in the cloud was 33 days, which totals 40. And on the fourth day, the sun was placed into the sky, and that sun is a type of the sun, Yahshua the Messiah.
That's right.
So the S-U-N is a type of the S-O-N. Okay. So on the sixth day, in that Moses vision, you got man being formed. So Adam here was formed from the dust of the earth. Eve was taken out of his womb. They were in a heavenly state. And what happened was that the Lucifer, the serpent, they were in a heavenly state, and Lucifer tempted Eve, and she ate of the fruit. And then Adam also ate of the fruit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just a big
picture. Stand on the other side. Thank you.
So they're in this heavenly state where Eve is tempted by Lucifer. She partakes of the fruit, gives it to Adam. He does as well. And at that point, their eyes are open to the flesh. Mm-hmm. And then they were driven out of the garden on the 40th day, and that's according to that vision of Moses. Okay. And let's see, could we get the Isaiah 28, 9 and 10?
Isaiah 28, 9 and 10.
9 and 10.
9 and 10. Whom shall he teach knowledge? And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast. For precept must be upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here little and there little. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. To whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest, and this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear.
Okay, that's good. So, when they say it's line upon line, precept upon precept, that is a principle. And that principle shows on these charts as a principle of spirit, blood, and water. And on this plate, the blood means death, and the death was Adam, and again in that...
No, we should show, go to the other one.
This one?
To your left. To your left, yeah. That one, yes.
Yeah, Adam being driven out. And the principle here, the death principle here on this chart is Adam being driven out on the 40th day. And 40th meaning change. Like there's change taking place because they...
That's right.
Went from a heavenly state to carnality, fleshly state. And another thing I want to mention about the tabernacle, that tabernacle was built, representing the principle of 40, was built in 40 weeks. Okay, let's see here. And Genesis 1 and 15. Oh wait, actually, never mind. Can I get Genesis 6 and 17?
Genesis 6 and 17. And behold, I, even I, do bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh, wherein is the breath of life, from under the heavens, and everything that is in the earth shall perish. But with thee will I establish my covenant, and thou shalt come into the ark, thou and thy sons, and thy wife, and thy sons' wives with thee. And of every living thing of all flesh, two of every sort shalt thou bring into the ark, to keep them alive with thee. They shall be male and female, of birds according to kind, and of cattle according to kind, and of every creeping thing of the earth, according to kind, two of every sort shall come unto thee to keep them alive.
Okay, that's it. So Moses gave the warning to the people that there was going to be a flood, and so they were warned. The death principle here is that the blood is on their heads, as you can see here. And the 40 principle here is that it did rain for 7 days and seven nights. 40 days and 40 nights. And they went into the ark. They were in the ark during that time, 40 days and 40 nights. Moses, I'm going to talk about Moses a bit here. So Moses was raised up, he was a Hebrew, but he was in Israel, and he was there for 40 years before he killed an Egyptian and he fled, and he was in the wilderness for 40 years, and then at 80, Yahweh talked to him. Can you get Exodus 3, 7? 10 or 7.
Exodus 3:7. And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I came down, and I am come down to deliver them out of the land of Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land unto a good land, and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore...
That's good.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. So Moses was commanded to deliver these children of Israel, who were in bondage for 400 years, out of Egypt.
That's right.
Okay, then they had to cross. Well, there was a Passover, and there was Passover lamb. And let's see, the past, another principle of 40 is that the lamb was held over 4 days, and that's because Yahshua came in on the 4,000th year, or the fourth day, which is here. And so, yeah, they crossed the Red Sea, which is another change. And then they were in the wilderness for another 40 years. And let's see here. Can I get Numbers 8:28?
Numbers 28. 28. Take the rod, and gather thou the assembly together, and thou and Aaron thy brother, and speak ye unto the rock before their eyes, and it shall give forth his water, and thou shalt bring forth to them water out of the rock. So thou shalt give the congregation and their beasts drink. And Moses took the rod from before Yahweh as he commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the congregation together before the rock, and he said unto them, Hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch you water out of this rock? And Moses lifted up his hand, and with his rod he smote the rock twice, and the water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beasts also. And Yahweh spake unto Moses and Aaron, Because ye believe me not to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore ye shall not bring the congregation into the land which I have given them.
Thank you. That's good. So, because Moses smote the rock,
that's right,
Yahweh did not allow him to cross over into the promised land, which is Canaan's land. So he was only to see it from the River Jordan, and then he died at 120. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he died at 120. Can I get Acts 1?
Acts 1 and 3. to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh. And being assembled together, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which said he, ye have heard of me.
Okay, that's good. So Yahshua was on the earth 40 days after he was killed, death, buried, and resurrected. So is that right? So I hope that helps anybody out with an understanding of that principle of four. And thank you.
Hallelujah.
Our next speaker this morning will be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good evening, class. It's always a pleasure.
Good morning.
I guess I'm always coming at night, right? Good morning, class. It's always a pleasure and an honor to stand before the assembly of Yahshua and testify of some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. Now, the topic today is about the principle of 40. And I asked her to do that particular topic. Because there's principles that we have a tendency to run over and don't fully understand the basic reality of what the principle of 40 is all about.
Right.
Now, in that, she laid a good foundation. When you see the number 4, 40, 400, 4,000, that is symbolic of a change.
Yeah.
Something has to happen when you see the principle of 4, 40, 4,000, 400, 4,000. Remember, the zeros are just placeholder. At the end of the day, the principle is just 4. That makes sense?
Yes.
All right. So, Matthew 5:17. When Yahshua the Messiah, who is Yahweh manifested in a physical body, or Yahweh Elohim as the son of Yahshua. Remember, Yahweh is spirit. You see, he is made up of these divine attributes of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge. Beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. This is what he is, yet he abides therein. The moderator said this, that Yahweh chose to symbolize himself as a cloud, because the cloud have no particular or descriptive shape and form. Nevertheless, this cloud is drawn all around the edges of the chart to show you how that everything in the universe abides within the cloud. But in reality, you cannot see Yahweh in his abstractness or in his pure spirit state or in his ontological state of perfection. You just cannot.
Right.
So what it did, it behooved him to come into a state and condition which is an incorporeal state and form as Yahweh, you see, in a sonship degree, or this is now Elohim, or Yahweh Elohim, or Yahweh incarnated as Elohim, who is the archetype or the original pattern of the universe. You see, and in this state condition, that is, in the incorporeal state, you can see him, not with your physical eyes, but with your consciousness.
Right.
or he appear within your consciousness, and you communicate, and you talk to him, and he leads you, and he guides you, and he gives you direction. Talking about the shape and form, or Yahweh as the Son of Yahweh. Then this shape and form manifests as the entire universe.
Right.
That is the angelic creation as well as the physical creation. And as she already brought up, in the beginning was the Word, because this shape and form is the Word.
Right.
The Word was with Yahweh, and this Word, listen, was Yahweh. All things, talking about the universe, you see, or the creation, all things therein was made by the Word. But also the Word was made flesh. Meaning this, the shape and form manifested in a physical body, that is, as Yahshua Messiah. As it was already brought out, the Word was made flesh. You see, now that is the unity of the Spirit. Now read, you see, here come Yahshua Messiah, as she already talked about, how that the Son was placed in on the fourth day. So it's already been documented that Yahshua Messiah came in, and he manifested through his mother's womb, that is, in the 4,000 year or on the fourth day. You see? So therefore, prior to that time, we have the law and the prophets to use as a witness to identify and to point out who Yahshua the Messiah was and when he was going to come. And when he got here, what he was going to do, how he was going to do it, when he was going to do it, and how he was going to take this thing out. All that is laid down in the law, which is the first five books of your Bible, and the prophets. That when Yahshua comes in, he comes in to fulfill,
right,
and to move that out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
What does fulfill mean? It means to bring into reality. That's what it means. To complete, to end, you see, as a promise. To bring to its full potentiality. You see, it means to execute. It also means to perform. That's what fulfill means. But you got to see the reality of what he's fulfilling. Now read. Now this is what the Messiah said when he walked around on the Palestine Judean hills.
Matthew 5:17.
Mm-hmm.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Go ahead.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
So, he says, I did not come to destroy it, but I come to bring it to reality. Read, please.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one yod, or the smallest part of the letter, shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Now he says, now listen, when I get here, you see, I'm going to do some fulfilling. But when I get through, I'm going to make sure all my T's are crossed. I'm going to make sure all my I's are dotted. You will have no question to understand that I am who I said I am. And that is Yahweh manifested in the body. All right? That's what I said when I walk around in a physical body. Now, this is what I'm telling you after I die and I bury and I resurrect. Now, read.
Hold on.
Luke 24:25. Now, what he said in the flesh, he has to also say in the spirit after his resurrection. Because he's fulfilling. You see, and while you're at it, I want you to pick up real quick. She already brought it out. Acts, you see, the first chapter. And just hold on to that because Yahshua is fulfilling. We ain't got no rookies in here, but let me say this. We have a pattern that we operate by. You see, and we have steps to our tabernacle pattern. The gate is one because you got to enter in. You see, the altar of sin sacrifices where the priest, well, see, you would put the sacrifice on the animal, which was slain, and the blood is placed on the four horns of the altar, which represents the earth, all right? And then the third step, you see, is your labor where there's washings, you see, that takes place in this labor. And the labor is representation of the waters and the seas and the lakes and the rivers and things of that sort, all right? And then there's holy anointing oil, which is actually at the door, where the high priest, you see, will pour on his head first before he can officiate in, that is, in the holy place and in the most holy place. But the cup is at the door. The Spirit is not here, but the Spirit is actually here. Now, going into the door, and the door itself in reality is actually the first department of El, which is blue, purple, and scarlet. Now, the holy place and all of its contents, You see, it's the fifth step in our pattern. You see, with the seven branch golden lampstand, the table of shewbread, and also the altar of incense. You see, and that incense will walk up into the most holy place to prevent Yahweh from smelling the stench of these animals that is burning here out here on this ark. Nevertheless, this door represents four. It's four steps from the gate. You see, now if you know how far you are from the gate, you also should know how far you are from, that is, perfection right here. But the principle is the door. Now, that's the fourth step in our pattern. Now watch. There has to be a change. You're coming from the court roundabout, or the flesh, into the holy place where these furnishings are made of what? Gold. The furnishings in the most holy place is made of gold. These furnishings out here are made of brass. So there's a change as you enter in. These vessels, listen, they're covered up by a veil. Whereas these vessels are exposed. But there's a change that's taking place when you enter to the door right here, which we're going to look at the reality of that in just a minute. Nevertheless, this is our pattern. And of course, the second departmental veil is our sixth step in our pattern. And then the Ark of the Covenant, which is in the most holy place, with the mercy seat, the two archangels looking directly at Yahweh, making up the throne of Yahweh, that is your step and seventh step in your pattern, or it is perfection, whereby you have Yahweh himself sitting, you see, on the throne, and in the midst of the cloud, let me say that again, that is, in the midst of the cloud, Yahweh himself, Yahweh Elohim, is in the midst of that cloud. Everybody with me so far? Yes. Now, with that being said, this is man-made, that is, man-made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle. Because it is Yahweh Elohim who fathered or gave birth, that is, to the man. So, this tabernacle is no more than a reflection of your physical body. I'm pointing to this chart here, but I'm actually talking about you. Alright? So what you see here, that is in the tabernacle pattern, which Yahweh revealed to the man Moses when he was called up in the mount, then you should understand it is a reflection of the man himself. And everything in the universe has to operate and reflect. You see, I'm talking about within you what Yahweh purposed and declared, that is, back here in the cloud. Now, here's Yahshua after his death, his burial, and his resurrection, because he says he's fulfilling, right? Mm-hmm. So now, he has to tarry on earth for 40 days. Right? Mm-hmm. Now, we're going to read that in a minute. Now, Luke 24:25. Read.
Then he said unto them,
read.
O fools, and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
Okay. Go ahead.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things,
uh-huh,
and enter into his glory?
Read on.
And beginning at Moses.
If you begin all the way back from Exodus, all the way down, you see, through the Genesis, Numbers, Deuteronomy, you see, and Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, make up the law and the prophets, read.
And in all the prophets,
uh-huh,
he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
Now remember, this is his death. This is his burial. You follow me? And here's the resurrection. You notice the resurrection is not below this line. It's above that line. You see, because Yahshua says, I am the door. You see, in fulfillment, of this lamb being placed on this altar back here, that he is the door. See, this lamb, the blood of the lamb, is placed on the door. Yahshua himself is a representation of the blood of the lamb. But the fact of the matter is, after his death, his burial, and his resurrection, he tarried on earth, is right there on your chart, for 40 days.
Right.
You see, now, let's get some book on that. That's Acts, the first chapter. You can start at 1 and read down, please.
Acts 1. The former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Yahshua began both to do and teach.
Now let me say this. Luke wrote the book of Acts. And what Acts is talking about and discussing, that is the Acts
of the 12 apostles,
right,
you see, after Yahshua's death, burial, and resurrection. Because their duty and their job was to witness and confirm,
right,
what Yahshua was doing, and that you and I might be recipients of the gift of the Holy Spirit. So since there is a principle of 40 in this tabernacle, she already brought it out, it was 40 weeks in the building. So therefore, Yahshua has to also fulfill that 40. After his death, burial, and resurrection, he carried on earth for 40 days. Now Luke is telling us about what this man was doing, you see, prior to his death, burial, and resurrection, and yet, what's going to happen? Read on, please.
Two. Until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments, mm-hmm, unto the apostles,
read,
whom he had chosen,
read,
to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs,
uh-huh,
being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of Yahweh.
Now that's why that principle is 40 is right there on your chart. Because Yahshua resurrected a quickening spirit, not a physical body.
Right.
Now, and then he tarried on earth for 40 days. Now, I'm kind of deviating. I just feel like I have to just do this for these recovering Catholics. You see, these recovering Christians. You see, that Christianity teaches that Yahshua resurrected a physical body.
Right.
You see. And then they talk about, they say, well, he has to be physical because he's eating meat.
Right.
He's eating fish, walking through doors and all that kind of stuff. Right? Now, we talked about last week about the fish. I was supposed to talk about this Friday night, but I'm going to hit this right now. John, 21st chapter, that I didn't get a chance to hit this right quick. But I just want to make this principle, you see, because this is so-called Lent. Mm-hmm. Right? And for 40 days, right, you're supposed to sacrifice something. So some folks say, well, we not eating no meat. We having fish. Right? Mm-hmm. And the Messiah called the fish meat. So you're delusional if you don't think fish is meat. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, let's read.
John 21 and 1.
No. Start about, hit 8. I think that's where I want to start. This is when Yahshua shows up.
John 21 and 8.
I think that's where it is.
And the other disciples came in a little ship, for they were not far from the land. But it was worth 200 cubits, dragging a net with fishes.
And that's too far down. Start about, you know what? Go ahead. Start it. That's fine. Go ahead. Go ahead. Can you see reading?
9. As soon then as they were come to the land, they saw a fire of coals there and fish laying thereon.
Go ahead.
Bread.
Read on.
Yahshua said unto them,
go ahead.
Bring up the fish which ye have now caught.
Read on.
Simon Peter went up and drew the net to the land full of great fishes.
Now look, he's already resurrected at this point.
Mm-hmm.
All right, this is where everybody's tripping over. Let's read.
153.
He caught 153 fish after he told him to cast the net on the other side. Because they had fished all night, and they caught nothing. He told him to cast this fish, a net on the other side, and they caught 153 fish. Now that 153 represents, you see, the three Pentecosts, you see, that Yahshua, you see, performed, that is, he entered his ministry at the age of 30.
Right.
You see, but Pentecost represents 50.
Right.
So for 3.5 years in his ministry, he ate, following the Passover supper. Mm-hmm. So there were three suppers, or three Passovers, you see, that he went. So that represents 50 for each one of those Passovers. No. And then 3 days. Three Pentecosts. You see, for each one of those 50. The principle of the 50. However, he was in the heart of earth for 3 days and 3 nights. But each one of those days represent a Pentecost. That's 153 fish. Mm-hmm. And fulfillment, you see, of him walk around for 3.5 years. That's what those fish represent. All right? Keep reading.
And for all there were so many, yet was not the net broken.
Read on.
Yahshua said unto them,
read.
Come and dine. And none of the disciples durst ask him, who art thou?
Read.
Knowing that it was he.
Read.
Yahshua then came and took the bread and fish and gave them to eat.
Go ahead.
This is now the third time that Yahshua showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead.
Now he appeared 11 times, but this was the third time, all right? Let's read, please.
So when they had dined, Yahshua said unto Simon Peter,
read.
Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me more than these? He said unto him, yea, Rabbi, thou knowest that I love thee.
Mm-hmm.
He saith unto him, feed my lambs. He said to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me much? He said unto him, yea, Rabbi.
Hold on. That's not what I want. I apologize for you. Go to 20 and 25. Man, make it 24. What I want to talk about is Thomas. When Thomas sees Yahshua, he didn't believe it was him. I apologize for that. This is what I want.
24. Okay, but Thomas, one of the 12, called
Didymus,
thank you, was not with them when Yahshua came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen Yahshua.
Uh-huh.
But he said unto them,
uh-huh,
except I shall see in his hand,
yes,
the print of the nails,
yes,
and put my finger,
uh-huh,
in the print of the nails,
go ahead,
and thrust my hand into his side,
read.
I will not believe.
Go ahead, read on.
And after 8 days again, his disciples were with them within, and Thomas with them. Then came Yahshua, the doors being shut,
so,
and stood in the midst.
So look here, and he showed up walking through the doors, right? Mm-hmm. All right? Yeah. Now, I don't scare the hell out of anybody, right? Mm-hmm. Me, for sure. But read, please.
And said, peace be unto you.
Read.
Then saith he to Thomas.
Now he see, Yahshua already read his unexpressed thoughts.
Right.
And he's with his posse talking about the 11. So Thomas had already put the Messiah on blast. And everybody else, unless this goes on, blah, 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 I ain't gonna believe it. You see, now Christianity have a different take on that. Read, please.
Then said he to Thomas,
read.
Reach hither thy finger and behold my hand.
He says, now reach hither. Come on, put your hand out, and behold means to look. Now, what Christianity says that when he looked with his hand, he put his hand and started rubbing into the print.
Right.
Because behold means to look. So the question is, how do you look with your hand? You look by searching and touching. You get my point? That did not happen here. But it appears to be. Do you understand what I'm saying? Read, please.
And reach hither thy hand,
read,
and thrust into my side.
In other words, you go ahead and just do it. Read.
Be not faithless, but believing.
Read.
And Thomas answered and said unto him,
uh-huh,
Yahushua,
read,
my Elohim.
Uh-huh.
Yahshua said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed.
Now, he never touched him.
Right.
He
never put his hands on him.
Right.
He just believed. Because once he showed his hand, they saw it. The book says he believed. Did you read that? Or you didn't catch it? Because you're looking at me crazy.
Oh, no, yeah.
Oh, you got it. Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. So that's my point I wanted to make about that issue. Now, pick up 1 Corinthians 15:45, and we're going to read that, and we're going to get up on my head and get back to the principle of what we're talking about, and that's the principle of 40. It's just that during this time, it was during the 40 days that this event happened, which made this relevant. You follow what I'm saying? To what we're talking about. Let's read.
1 Corinthians 15:45. And so it is written,
mm-hmm,
the first Adam was made a living soul.
Talking about this one here.
And the last Adam was made a life-giving spirit.
So therefore, you got to understand, Adam, you see, who was formed from the dust of the earth, is the first Adam. Yahshua fulfilling, he is considered the second Adam.
Right.
All right?
Slide that over. That chart slide it over to the Adamic plate, and you can correlate both of them together.
Oh, come on, this one.
Yeah, slide it over. Yeah. The Adamic, then you can just make the...
Oh, okay, to make the comparison.
Yeah.
All right. This is the first act.
Set of camera angles.
This is the second act. All right? This is the resurrected Yahshua. This is Adam in form from the dust of the earth.
Oh, or that one.
This is the resurrected. This is the resurrected Adam, and this is the one being formed from the dust of the earth. Is that okay?
You want that plate?
12. I'll take it.
12.
I'll take 12. Matter of fact, I got to get it anyway. It's the better plate.
Whoa! Oops. What happened?
It's America.
Staple, come on, is there attack?
You
know it's attack. You put it on me.
Tell me
there's
attack.
There's attack.
Where?
I should let you come over here, Lord, and do this. Blow your heart out.
I'm just kidding about that. You be sure to put that thing, that attack back in there. Be sure to pray. Okay, here we go. This is the first Adam. This here is the second Adam. You see? And so, let's read, please.
Howbeit, that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterwards that which is spiritual.
Go ahead.
The first Adam is of the earth earthy.
Now, the first Adam, that is of the earth earthy. Read on.
The second Adam is Yahshua from heaven.
Now, the second Adam is Yahshua.
Right. To your right. Okay. To your right. There's the plate.
This one here.
No.
Oh, this one.
Yes. Yeah.
That's what you meant.
See, it's better camera. That way you don't, I don't have to go down like that.
I got it now. The second Adam is Yahshua from heaven. Let's read, please.
As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy.
Go ahead, read.
And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly.
Now, he's born from the dust of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
He's in a heavenly state. This one here is Yahshua being placed in the womb, you see, and was born by way of immaculate conception. In him there is no sin. So he was the true acceptable sacrifice
that
Yahweh had created and declared way back in around eternity, you see, the place to bring him in to atone for all mankind's sins. You see, that's him. The principle we're looking for, did he raise physically? Or did he raise spiritually? Read, please.
And as we have borne the image of the earthy,
read.
We shall also bear the image of the heavenly.
So just as we borne the image of the earthy, we can also borne the image of, that is, of the heavenly. So we all got to fall. You see, just as Adam fell, you too have to fall. You see, and we know that Adam was in that garden for 40 days, that is, according to Moses' vision, which we're going to draw out in a minute.
Right.
But after 40 days, he had to make an exodus, that is, out of the land of Egypt. You see, I mean, out of that garden at this particular time. She already brought it up, how that the creation was created in 7 days, and Moses was a witness to that. You see, and then for the next 33 days, you see, Moses received divine specifications on how to build and construct that tabernacle pattern.
Right.
But after that 40 days, there had to be a change. He had to come down, that is, out of the garden, and that is back, oh man, into the flesh, you see, or into that physical body, because here, he's having a vision. You understand? He's having vision, so now he's putting that body back on, and he has to go back and deal with the stiff neck, uncircumcised, egotistical, misdirected personalities down here, or these carnal minds. That's what he has to do. You know what I mean? Now, go back to 1545. I need a King James Version when you read that, though.
What verse?
1545.
First Corinthians?
See, when you read in the Holy Name, it doesn't do it injustice. Read the Holy Name.
And so it is written, the first man Adam was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit.
Oh, that's King James.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what you want. That's accurate. Holy Name doesn't say that. What does Holy Name say?
And so it is written, the first Adam was made a living soul. the last Adam was made a life-giving spirit.
That's a great big difference. But when he's resurrecting a quickening spirit, it didn't say he's resurrecting a physical body. That's the point I'm trying to get you to see. Mm-hmm. And that's where Christianity gets lost, because they keep looking at him eating fish. They say, well, he's eating fish. Mm-hmm. He got to be physical. You see, 1550.
Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahweh.
No.
Neither does corruption inherit incorruption.
Now what he said was, how is it that the spirit has flesh and bone, as you see me have? Mm-hmm. How is it that a spirit has flesh and bone, not flesh and blood?
Right.
Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom, not flesh and bone. Mm-hmm. All right? I just want to make that point and get back to the principles we talked about. Now, let's head back over to John 5:39. I'm going to read that and then I'm going to move a little bit, a little quicker. Now, here's the Messiah walk around the Palestine Judean hills, and he's confronting these carnal-minded Jews at this particular time. You see, he's fulfilling. You see, that's what he's doing. They do not understand that he's fulfilling.
Right.
Only thing they have is the law and the prophets. But when they read the law and the prophets, they do not think that's Joseph and Mary's boy that he's talking about. Although everything that he was doing, you follow me, healing the sick, calling the blind to see, the dumb to speak, and the deaf to hear. He's raising the dead. You see, these are the things that he was doing when he was walking around, that is, on the Palestine Judean hills in a physical body. But they didn't see that as Joshua or the King of Kings. They didn't see that. They just know that that's Joseph and Mary's boy or the carpenter's son. That's all they see, and that's all they want to see. Right. Let's read, please.
John 5 and 39.
Yeah.
Ye search the scriptures,
uh-huh,
for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me.
Go ahead.
But ye will not come to me, that ye might have life.
Read.
I receive not honor from men.
Read.
But I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
Read on.
I am come in my Father's name.
Read on.
And ye receive me not.
Now we ain't going to draw that out too much, but we already made it perfectly clear. There are similarities in these names. Yahshua, Yah, you see, is the master portion of the name. Yah is the master portion of the Father's name. There are similarities. We all come in our Father's name, and that's where we get the disposition from, that when we're born, male or female, we take on the male characters, you see, or the male's last name, you see, which is our true surname. That's what's happening here. You see, he is the Son, and Yeshua means salvation. You see, and this is just an abbreviation of Yahweh. But you got to see, if Yah is masculine and Way is feminine, this is just an abbreviation, but the Way is hidden, that is, in Yah. This is, in reality, Yahweh is the Savior.
Right.
That's a fulfillment of what Yahweh did back here. That is, when he set the sacrifice up right here. That's the sacrifice that is set up before the foundation of the world.
Right.
So therefore, when these ignorant Christians walk in and say, are you saved? Have you been saved yet? You've already been saved when Yahweh appeared within the cloud. Wake up. Because that is the sacrifice that had been slain before the foundation of the world. What you're seeing right here is a manifestation or fulfillment of this sacrifice right here. So Yahweh already saved you before you showed up on the scene. You don't have to do nothing to be saved, because the Savior or the sacrifice has already been prepared, that is, before the creation was assembled by a pattern. Read, please.
Let another come in his own name, him ye will receive.
Go ahead.
How can ye believe which receive honor one of another?
Go ahead.
And seek not the honor that cometh from Elohim only.
Read.
Do not think I will accuse you to the Father.
Mm-hmm.
There is one that accuses you, even Moses, in whom ye trust.
Yeah.
For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me, for he wrote of me.
Yeah.
But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words? Yeah. And the Jews marvel.
That's enough right there. Now, I don't care what version of the Bible you have. If you could find Jesus any place in the law, you follow me, and the prophets, we'll shut the school down and go home and watch basketball today. You see, because you're not going to find no place where Moses is writing about Jesus, folks.
Right. Right.
Now, he did write about Joshua, the son of Nun, who is correctly Yahshua. That's who he is. But he did not write about Jesus for a number of reasons. But the main one, this is Greek origin. This is Greek. It's a combination of a Greek guy, sky god Zeus, and an Enid, you see, a Babylonian deity. He did not write about Jesus. Second reason, there is no J in the Hebrew alphabet to this day. There never was a J in the Hebrew, the Greek, or the Latin, that is, to this day. So he's not writing about Jesus. He's writing about Yahshua. You see, now that's hard for some people to see, then that's fine. That has to be revealed. Now, let's head back to the burning bush back here, all right? Because Joshua instructed us to go back to Moses. That's why we labor so much about Moses, you see. Now, pick up the third chapter of Genesis, and I also want you to pick up the Genesis 15 and 12. Now, Abraham, you see, was the first Hebrew,
right.
You see, and he crossed the Euphrates River. That's what makes him the first Hebrew, you see. And it comes, Hebrew comes the word from the word Habiru, which means one who crossed the river. And the river that he crossed was the Euphrates River. Now, Abraham had two sons. One was Isaac and the other one was Ishmael. Ishmael set up the Gentile nation, and Isaac was the seed of promise.
Right.
Isaac had a set of twins, Esau and Jacob, and Jacob had 12 sons, which makes up the 12 tribes of Israel, or what they sometimes call the Israelites, or they sometimes they call the sons of Jacob. At the end of the day, they are the children of Israel, and they are Abraham's descendants, if you will. All right? Now, the question is, Abraham was up here in Canaan's land, and the children of Israel, or the 12 tribes, was up here in Canaan's land. And there was a famine that forced them and made them go down into the land of Egypt. And I'm not getting into the whole story, but the fact of the matter, Joseph was sold down into slavery.
Right.
You see, and he was already down there. And it was him who received them and got them down there, and that is in the land of Joseph. But, land of Goshen, but there was a famine that caused them to go down here in the land of Egypt. That's how they got down there. And listen, the reason why they're down there, because Yahweh already promised and declared that he's going to put them there. It was already brought out the other day, this morning. Read, please, Genesis 15, 12.
Genesis 15 and 12. And when the sun was going down,
uh-huh.
A deep sleep fell upon Abram.
Read on.
And lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him.
Read.
And he said unto Abram,
uh-huh.
Know of a surety that thy seed shall be greater in the land
uh-huh.
that is not theirs.
Now that's Egypt. Read on.
And shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years.
So they're going to be down here for 400 years. You see, Yahweh purposed that to happen. So you should know that after 400, they have to make, there's got to be a change. They have to make an exit. The word exodus means outgoing. So they had to make a change or have to make an exodus out of the land of Egypt. And Yahweh already set that up way back here in the realm of eternity, you see, when he brought Moses in. All right? Now, let's pick up Genesis 1 and 2. I have 1 and 2, but 2:15.
Genesis 2:15.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh Elohim said, it is not good that man should be alone.
I apologize. Exodus 2:15.
Exodus
2:15.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I'm talking about Moses.
Right.
And what I'm doing, I'm showing you how Yahweh got Israel down here in the land of Egypt. And said they're going to be down here for some 400 years. Now, after 400 years, it has to be a setup for them to get up out of there. Since Yahweh put them down there. And he said they're going to be evenly entreated and go to a land they not know of for 400 years. So now it's time for them to come out. And Yahweh told Joseph, you see, and the Israelite, that Elohim will surely visit you, which you read in the 50th chapter of Genesis, which we're not going to read. Let's read, please.
Exodus 2:15. Now when Pharaoh heard this thing, he sought to slay Moses. But Moses fled from the face of Pharaoh and dwelt in the land of Midian.
Mm-hmm.
And he sat down by a well. Now the priests of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came and drew water and filled the trough to water their father's flock.
Now hold it right there. Pick it up at 2 and 1.
And there went a man of the house of Levi mm-hmm. and took to wife a daughter of Levi. And the wife excuse me, and the woman conceived and bare a son.
Mm-hmm.
And when she saw him, that he was a goodly child,
uh-huh.
she hid him 3 months.
Read on.
And when she could not no longer hide him,
read.
She took for him an ark of bulrush,
mm-hmm.
and dabbed it with lime and with pitch,
read.
And put the child therein, and she laid it in the flag by the river brink.
Go ahead, now, read on.
And his sister stood afar off and find out what would be done to him.
Because see, there's a death decree going on.
Mm-hmm.
So what Moses' mother's doing, who wants their mother, their child to die? We don't care. We're raising them. My kid got killed. So therefore, she put her kid in an ark of bulrushes and put him in the river, in the river by the flags, right? Let's read.
And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maiden walked along by the riverside. And when she saw the ark among the flags,
mm-hmm.
she sent her maid to fetch it.
So she heard the baby crying, you see, and Pharaoh's daughter was bathing, you see, because see, the Nile River was considered the river of fertility, you see, and she ain't had no kids, all right? Now read on, please.
And when she had opened it, she saw the child.
So she sees Moses, read on.
And behold, the boy wept, and she had compassion on him,
mm-hmm.
and said, this is one of the Hebrew children.
Read on.
Then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child
now,
for thee?
Now, Moses' sister is watching this thing. All right? And then she goes up to Pharaoh's daughter and makes these comments about finding somebody to nurse the child. See how Yahweh's working his purpose. You see, read, please.
And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go. And the maid went and called the child's mother.
Uh-huh.
And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages.
So she's paying the mama to feed the baby.
Mm-hmm.
Well, wherefore, fair. Read on, please.
And the woman took the child and nursed it.
Read on.
And the child grew, and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter.
Read.
And he became to her a son.
Mm-hmm.
And she called his name Moses.
Read.
And she said, because I drew him out of the water.
So the name Moses means one drawn out.
Right.
All right, let's read, please.
And it came to pass in those days, when Moses was grown, that he went out unto his brethren and looked on their burden.
Read.
And he saw an Egyptian smiting an Hebrew,
read.
One of his brethren.
Read.
And he looked this way and that way.
Now listen, at that time, when he was grown, he was 40 years old.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's the principle.
Yes.
It's time for him to get up out of there, you see, because he's 40.
Mm-hmm.
And we're looking at the purpose. And Yahweh has carried out his purpose through the Hebrews. So now Moses has been born down here and reared up in Pharaoh's household for 40 years.
Right.
Now after 40 years, he goes out among his brethren. And don't get me wrong, Moses was living a pretty decent lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
All right? He has no idea what's in front of him.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens, he ends up, you see, going out among his brethren, and he sees a Hebrew and an Egyptian fighting. Moses intercedes, kills the Egyptian, buries him in the sun, saying, he goes out the next day among his brethren, seeing two brothers fighting, and he intervenes again.
Right.
You see? And they said, what you going to do? You going to kill me like you did that Egyptian? So Moses knew that the thing was out, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he ended up fleeing for his life. Now listen, folks, he did not swim the Red Sea. He went by way of the Philistines, you see, which is a trade route. That's how he got out there. My point, 40, there's a change. He got to get up out of the land of Egypt, all right? He's out here in the wilderness, you see, that is for 40 years, you see, and that's where he meet his wife, you see, and he have his kids, but for 40 years, he ain't living too bad either. You see, he's tending his father-in-law's sheep. They not his sheep. They his father-in-law's sheep, which is the priest, Reuel. You see, just like Yahshua, when he comes in, he's come to gather, you see, the father's sheep. They not his sheep, but they're the father's sheep.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, my sheep will hear my voice.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll be out here in the wilderness of Sinai, you see, and now Moses is 80 years old, right?
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? There got to be a change.
Right.
Something has to happen, you see. Guess what? Read now. Exodus 3:1. Go ahead.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb.
Mm-hmm.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Uh-huh.
And looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Read on.
And Moses said, I would now turn aside and see this great sight,
uh-huh,
why the bush does not burn.
Now read.
And when Yahweh saw that he had turned aside to see,
would he have attention? When he had his attention.
Yeah.
All right? Because you're looking at the bush. But he got his attention now. One, he's scared. You see? Now you got to pay attention. Collect yourself, boy. You know what I mean? Read, please.
Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush.
Read.
And said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither.
No, well, don't come no closer.
But put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground.
Now here are the shoes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the founder told us that the creation is the greater and more perfect tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
So you see down here in the chart here, this is painted black, showing forth darkness. And you guys know, we all, talking about us, we got to grow up. And it's rough growing up from 0 to 40. You see, and everybody know that after 40, talking about you men, you have a culture shock. We have low T count. The testosterone go down so low, your whole life changes. You see, if you don't change, it will change for you. Your body start going to a different direction. Your prostate gland start getting big. And your desire, you see, you ain't like that pit bull when you was 19 anymore. You start acting like a little bit, like a goat. Now, calm down a little, like a little lamb a little bit. You stay home a little longer.
Speak for yourself.
You say you ain't figured out. My point is, there's a slowdown. You see, women, you know when you reach 40, you follow me? Guess what? There's a change taking place. Everything started changing. You got premenopause, you got perimenopause, and you got postmenopause. My point is, that's where it starts. Y'all get the point. My point is, just as this principle of 40 is going on with Moses, it's going on with you. Because this chart takes your picture. So you got court right here on the chart. We have this is out of court, but it's court roundabout. You see? But this is the original writings. This is the flesh, and then you got right here on the chart, you got holy place
right
here, you see? And then you got most holy place. So when you look at this chart, you're going to see the court roundabout, you're going to see the holy place, and you have the most holy place. However, you got Israel moving, listen, by this pattern, and they're not even conscious of there even such a thing as a pattern. Just like you're moving by the pattern. And you're not even conscious of the fact that there is a pattern. In this case, Moses is 40 years down here. Now he's 80 years. Now he's having experience with Yahweh. Alright? Now let's read on.
Moreover, he said,
uh-huh,
I am the Elohim of thy father,
uh-huh,
the Elohim of Abraham,
mm-hmm,
the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob.
Now that meant something to Moses. Those were his forefathers. You see? Let's read.
And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Read.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt.
So he let him know, I'm just not know any old angel talking to you out of the midst of the bush. I know what's going on down there. And listen, it's already been brought out. He took his shoes off. Because on the bottom of your feet, you got what we call a soul, right?
Right.
But Yahweh is dealing with Moses' soul, which is the S-U-L, and not the S-O-L-E.
Right.
But it's an expression of being humbled, if you will. You follow what I'm saying? Let's read on.
Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters.
Read on.
For I know their sorrow.
Now he says, I know what's going on down here. Let's read.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the land of the Egyptian, and to bring them up out of that land.
Now he said, now you look, Moses. I, Yahweh, am come down into the land of Egypt. He says, I'm come down. I'm down there. What Moses didn't know, he was already down there. Living down there with those Israelites down there in the land of Egypt. And listen, he showed up 2 years after Moses left, or at the end of the full 100 years. You see, which should give you that principle of 430. You say 430. That's why you got it right here on the chart, that the law was given 430 years. You see, the Abrahamic promise given 430 years, that is before the Mosaic law. You see, my point is that Yahshua showed up at the end, that is, of the 400 years, and there's a change taking place. You see? So he's down there having his experience down there, and Yahweh got everything in place, and now Moses is making an exodus out of the land of Egypt for 40 years. So 40 years later, he got to come back down here and deal with these people. All right? And he's commissioning Moses to go down here, that is, to the land of Egypt, right, and to confront Pharaoh. All right? Now, jump down to just pick up real quick. I just want to establish that. 13 verse.
And Moses said unto Elohim, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you.
Read.
And they shall say to me, what is his name?
Read.
What shall I say unto them? And Elohim said unto Moses, Eya Asher Eya.
So he gave him a descriptive phrase. He didn't give him a name. He says, I'll be what I will to be. That's what he said. He said, well, my name is Yahweh. You know, he said, I'll be what I will to be. Read.
And he said, thus shall thou say unto the children of Israel.
Now, when you get down there, you tell those folks this. But I'll be what I will to be. You understand? But you tell them this. Read.
I will be has sent me unto you.
Read on.
And Elohim said, moreover unto Moses.
On top of that, read.
Thus shall thou say unto the children
tell
of Israel.
Tell them this too. Read.
Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers.
Yahweh, the source and substance of the heavens and the earth. Creator of this celibate universe. That's who's talking to you. Read on, please.
The Elohim of Abraham.
Read.
The Elohim of Isaac.
Uh-huh.
And the Elohim of Jacob.
Read.
Has sent me unto you.
Read.
This is my name forever.
Uh-huh.
And this is my memorial unto all generations.
Now, listen. The J came into existence in the Middle Ages. His name was Yahweh long before J came into existence. You don't change his name. Now, you can argue tooth and nail with a Jehovah's Witness.
Right.
You can even cut his head off. He's still going to scream Jehovah. So, I'm letting you know, you just wasted your time talking to him. But it's not a good fight. It's still me, and you find out how much you know. But you think you're going to convert him? Oh, no. You're not going to convert him, but they're not coming down here unless they've been excommunicated or they've been disfellowshipped. Because when it's disfellowship, they got to sit back here. Let's see here. This is a big window right here. And they have about this many chairs. And everybody who disfellowship sits over here behind the window, but can't nobody speak to them or acknowledge them. You see? And just maybe they may get so bitter that they might talk to you because they're embarrassed and been exposed, of course, by the congregation. But they going to scream Jehovah until you can cut each finger off. They ain't going to change their mind. I'm letting you know right now. I don't waste my time. I just enjoy it. It's just like playing basketball, you know what I mean? Or playing checkers or chess. I just like the thrill of just talking to them. Because I already know I'm not going to, and just maybe I'll get one. But they'll bring somebody back, and they'll keep bringing somebody back. And then after a while, they say, don't go to his house no more. They put an X on the door. Your name goes in the book. Don't stop there no more. All right? That's how it is with those folks. All right? Now, let's move on. 16? Yeah. Six and three.
Yeah.
This is just for the new ones. This is for the new ones, the folks who don't know. Read.
16? 3 and 16, six, right?
3, 6, 6 and 3.
Oh.
Exodus 6 and 3. See, this is the first time Yahweh revealed the name to the man.
Right.
Right.
Dr. Kelly told us that.
Right.
Dr. Kelly also told us that Moses was born with the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
We didn't know that. Right. We didn't know that there was a setup. That Yahweh set this thing up. The founder revealed that to us. That everything has already been set up and been preordained way back here. Only thing we're doing is going through the motions. You see, it was already set up back here. And when Yahweh told the children of Israel, hey, listen, you're going to be down here for 400 years, that's when the 400 years started, as soon as he declared it.
You see, so it has to come to pass just like he said. Now let's read, please. This is for those folks who don't get it. Read.
Exodus 6 and 3.
Uh-huh.
And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob as El Shaddai.
Uh-huh.
But by my name Yahweh was I not known to them.
So they didn't know that that's the first time they ever revealed the name Yahweh. Now you can read Yahweh all the name Yahweh all back through the Genesis. And the reason why you see the name Yahweh all through the Genesis is because it was Joshua the son of Nun who was Yahweh manifested in the flesh. Called Moses up in the mountain and narrated the Genesis, that is, to Moses. And sometimes he would call Adam, Adam, and sometimes he would call him Elohim, you see, and sometimes he called him Yahweh. That's why you see that back there in Genesis. But nobody knew the name of Yahweh first, save Moses. That's the book, you see. And we have evidence of that in those two scriptures. So, anybody want to argue about it, we can argue about it later. But anyway, let's move on. Now, let's head on over to the 12th chapter of Exodus. Now, they got to get up out of here, you see. So Moses go back down here to confront Pharaoh, and he told him to let my son Israel go. All right? Now, he poured out 10 devastating plagues on Egypt. You see, the first three was experienced by the Egyptians as well as the Hebrews. The last seven was experienced by the Egyptians only. The ninth plague being stinging black darkness, and the tenth plague being the plague of death. Now remember, you see, Moses is 80 years old, and he had to go down here and deal with these carnal-minded people. And let me say this, there was nothing righteous in those folks. Absolutely nothing righteous. Meaning this, they were in darkness. They were in the same state and condition you're in prior to knowing anything about Yahweh. You're ignorant, you walk around in darkness, and you think you know. You're arrogant, you puffed up, and can't tell you nothing because all your knowledge came from the world. Yeah. You see? And you have a difficulty humbling yourself because there might be a 10-year-old could come up here and preach this gospel, and you can't. Mm-hmm. You see? Because it happened to every last one of us. You see? But the fact of the matter is, you see, when you humble yourself, you see, Yahweh reveal himself and he will show himself to you. I'll explain that in a minute. Read, please.
Exodus 12 and 1.
Read.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying,
mm-hmm.
This month shall be unto you the beginning of months.
Stop, Doc. What month is that? Exodus 13, 4. Read that real quick.
Exodus 13, 4. This day came ye out in the month
Abib. Now that's April. Abib, Abib correlates to our April. So now, Easter this year, believe me, is going to be April 1st. The so-called resurrection on Easter Day, April 1st. But anyway, let's read. So that's when Yahweh is now setting up time with Israel. All right? Read. It was already brought out earlier. Read on.
It shall be the first of the year to you.
Read.
Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the tenth day of this month.
Now look, in the tenth day of the month, come on.
They shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers.
Uh-huh.
A lamb for an house.
Uh-huh.
If the household be too little for the lamb,
read on.
Let him and his house take it according to the number of souls.
Read.
Every man according to his eating shall make your account for the lamb.
Read on.
Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year.
Mm-hmm.
You shall take it out from the sheep and from the goat.
Take it out from the sheep or from the goat. Now let me get this straight. There was no goats put on the altar.
Yeah.
And folks think that. Mm-hmm. There were some sheep that went among the goats.
Mm-hmm.
So take out a lamb. If it's with the sheep, just get him and you can slay him too. Now, folks used to teach this, and I did too, because I didn't know any better. That's why these folks act like that, because some of them ate goat. They didn't eat no goat. They all had a lamb. There was a lamb for everybody. And the reason why we know that, because everybody that's born, in order for you born, you have to poop before they let you go home. You see? And that's called meconium. It's a greenish-like substance.
because it proves and vindicates that you was partaking of that amniotic fluid as you was bathed and baptized in your mother's womb. You see, and I believe it's either a Greek word or a Latin word, which means lamb. Okay, so therefore you have to get that lamb in you, because and that proves that when you poop and you see that green is like meconium, that you did partake of that substance. And everybody, listen, everybody here had a lamb, because everybody on the earth, I'm telling you, you were bathed in that fluid and you partook of that fluid. So there was a lamb for everybody. Y'all with me so far? Read, please.
And ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the
same month. Now, there's 4 days. Hold over for dust. Take it out on the 10th. What are you talking about? You got to go to heaven. 9 principal attributes wrapped up into the one. That's the kingdom. That's 10, right? Mm-hmm. Hold it over for 4 days. That's 14. The son being placed in the heavens. You see? So therefore, you see, take out the lamb on the 10th and hold it over for 4 days and slew it between the two evenings. Let's read, please.
And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in between the two evenings.
Go ahead.
And they shall take up the blood.
Read.
And strike it on the two side posts.
Uh-huh.
And on the upper door of the houses.
Read.
Wherein they shall eat it.
Read.
And they shall eat the flesh in the night, roast with fire,
uh-huh,
and unleavened bread.
Go ahead.
And with bitter herbs.
Read.
They shall eat it.
Mm-hmm.
Eat not of it raw, nor boiled,
uh-huh,
at all with water.
Uh-huh.
But roast with fire.
Read.
His head with his legs and with the inwards thereof.
So now if you understand what we're talking about, this is the institution. This is the setup. This is the blueprint to tell you what's going to happen to him. Talking about the Messiah. He says, I am the door, so he says, put the blood on the top of the door, so he can put a crown of thorns on his head. Nail him in his hand, so put it on the two side posts, dip it from a basin, so nail him in his feet. Is dictating how this lamb is going to be killed. You see, I'm talking about the true lamb, you see, or the true lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. Because it's laid down in the scriptures. So if you understand what's in the law of the prophets, then you understand what's going to happen to him. You see, it's really just that simple. He is the sacrifice of sacrifice. This lamb, you see, as they pierced him in the side to drain the blood, likewise, you have to see a fulfillment of that. So you ought to get some smart folks come up in here and say, well, you know, what did that blood represent? Well, they had to kill the lamb down there. So what they did, in fulfillment, there was a thief and a robber on either side. That almost right. You see, and the people said, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. Is that right?
Yeah.
And so when they said crucify him, they chose Barabbas, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when they died and they got time, what they used to do at that time, it was a high day that when the Messiah got put on the cross, meaning it was a Sabbath day, but it was also a feast day. So they had to get them down off that cross. So what they would do to make them die faster, they would break their legs. All right?
Yeah.
So what they did, they broke the thief legs, you follow me?
Mm-hmm.
They passed over him and broke the robber's leg, because when they looked at him, they saw that he was already dead. So they just pierced him in the side. And fulfillment of them piercing that lamb in the side, because this was the true original Passover supper.
Mm-hmm.
So in that, this is the Passover supper. You see, therefore, he had to fulfill that. So they passed over him, not broke his leg, because the scripture says not a bone in his body can be broken. Alright? In fulfillment of the scriptures. Because everything he's doing is in direct fulfillment of the scriptures. Now, remember, when this event is taking place, this is after 400 years. So they can really make an exodus out of the land of Egypt. And when they go to the Red Sea, there was a 3-day journey to the Red Sea. Why 3 days? How long was the Messiah in the heart of earth?
3 days
and 3 nights. So this is fulfilling these 3 days back here. So when they go to the Red Sea, they have to go through, and the book says they were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. And it was led by this phenomenal cloud right here. And there was an angel in the midst of that cloud. And if you notice, we got this lined up right here. You see how the Messiah is getting baptized by John. And now all of Israel was his son. The book says this, Hoshea 11:1, you ain't got to get it. Out of Egypt, I call my son. So therefore, you see, Messiah is entering his ministry, and he had to get baptized or washed or bathed, because by him being the sacrifice here on the altar, You see, the next step in our pattern is the water. So therefore, he had to get baptized. And he's at the age of 30 when that takes place. Because a priest has to be at least 30 years old before he can officiate or function as a priest. That is in the tabernacle pattern right here. Nevertheless, here's the washing taking place, and they go through the Red Sea, and there's a cloud that led them, and they come out on the other side. So there's a principle of a death, there's a principle of burial, and then there's a principle of a resurrection on the other side. Why? Because Joshua had to die, and he had to bury, and he had to resurrect. But he also tarried, we got it right here on the chart, for 40 days. So, since he come from the lion tribe of Judah, which is one of the tribes, that means he had to tarry for 40 days. So how long did Israel tarry out here in the wilderness? 40 years. You see, because see, you know how we are. They wasn't going to be out here for 40 days, but they put up a, what you call it? A committee, covert operation to go over here to survey out the land. And they picked 12 men from each tribe. Now, one of them was Joshua. And I think I just got enough time. Pick up Numbers. I think I want 16 and 4. I think that's what I want. Is it 16 or is it 8? I think it's 16 and 4.
Numbers 16 and 4. And when Moses heard it, he fell upon his face, and he spake unto Koran and unto all his company, saying,
that's not what I want. Numbers. That Numbers?
Mm-hmm.
16. I may have got it wrong here. It might be. No, it's 4. As a matter of fact, I think exactly what it is. It's 13 and 8. Numbers 13 and 8.
Numbers 13 and 8? I don't think that's it. Is it the tribe of Ephraim of Hosea?
I think so. Yeah. You know what? Let me go back to 3 then. And read. Go back to 1 and then read down. But it's definitely 8, but I won't. Read on.
Numbers 12 and 3?
Got it? Fine. 13 and 3.
13 and 3. Okay, hold on. Yeah. I might have been. Oh, yeah, no. 13 and 3.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And Moses, by commandment of Yahweh, sent them from the wilderness of Paran.
Mm-hmm.
And those men were heads of the children of Israel.
Okay, read on.
And these were their names. Mm-hmm. Of the tribe of Reuben.
Uh-huh.
Shammua, the son of Zachor.
That's good. Now, I want you to jump down to 8. But my point, all tribes have a name right there.
Hoshea, the son of Nun.
Now, Hoshea was a son of Nun. He was one of the representatives who went over here to spy out this land in this covert operation over here. And they found out that the land was rich. I mean, it had a lot of fruit.
Right.
It was just a beautiful place, a lot of water, a place was there. It was going to be received their inheritance. But they had to take it, you see. But remember, Moses was 40 years down here in the wilderness, you see. He was out here in the wilderness for another 40 years with the children of Israel, because when they came out over here to survey out the land, they came back and they gave an evil report, an unfavorable report. And Yahweh is so mad, he can eat nails, he wanted to kill them. You see? But he said, you know what? Because the people said, well, we don't want to go over there and fight because we don't want our kids to die. And Yahweh said, I tell you what, your carcasses, you guys are going to die over here in the wilderness. But your kids will go over here, and they will fight, and they will take that land because they weren't doing no fighting in the first place. Yahweh's fighting all their battles. But that is a principle in this respect. See, the old man had to die, you see, and the new man can go over. So therefore, that was a type of mortality putting on immortality. And the offspring of the children of Israel and Moabite, they all died out. And I mean all of them in the wilderness, with the exception of Phinehas, Eleazar, and
Caleb.
You see, who was born down here in the land of Egypt. You see, went over here and took that land. And Joshua, son of Nun, he was not born down there, but he appeared down there 10 years after Moses. It was him, too, to come up out of there. But the three that was born down there was Caleb, Phinehas, and Eleazar. You see, representing the unity of the spirit. The point is, they went over here and they took that land. Now, remember, After 40 years, Moses ate in the burning bush. Now, she already brought it out. You see, he was out there for 40 years with them. You see, and so she had it read earlier, which we're not going to read it again. He told Moses, you see, before these people go over, to speak to the rock. What Moses did, he smote the rock. Now, the first time he come up by the way of the Indian, he told Moses to smote the rock. And he smote it, and water came, of course, to feed the people of the beast. The second time he told him was to speak to him, not smote the rock. So instead of speaking to the rock, he smote the rock. And he said, well, because of that, you're going to stay your honey down here in the land of Egypt. Now, you can look over here and see the promised land, but you ain't going over. But Yahweh set that up because it typified the cutting off of the flesh. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because this is the sixth step in your pattern. And this sixth step, talking about Jordan River, it points to Yahshua the Messiah. Because your second departmental veil is blue, purple, and scarlet, right? Mm-hmm. Now, when they beat him, I said when they beat him, his skin turned blue, purple, and scarlet. Mm-hmm. Just like it is when your mama beat you. You see, your skin turns blue, purple, and scarlet. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? So that's what happened to him. So that is your veil. So that was the veil of the flesh. You see, that's happening. So that's the cutting off, you see. And then they went over here in Canaan's land. Now when it was out here in Canaan's land, remember, the change took place. Moses is cut off. These folks, 40 years in the wilderness, now it's time to get on over here. There's change. So when they get up here, you see, they was ruled by the judges. You see? Mm-hmm. And then they asked for, before that, Joshua, son of Nun, fought all their battles, that is, for 40 years. Mm-hmm. All right? Yeah. And when he fought their battles for 40 years, of course, he died. You see? Now, after he died, there's a change to take place. You know how we are. Well, they want a king. They want to be just like the heathens. That's what they want. So Yahweh said, okay, I'll give you a king, but I made provision. I'm going to choose the king who you're going to have. Mm-hmm. So he gave him Saul. And everybody know, how long did Saul reign? 40 years. Yeah. Right? It was a satanic rule. All right? And after 40 years, there got to be another change, right? Mm-hmm. And then who showed up then? It was David. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
You see? And David, you see, he received divine specifications how to build Solomon's temple. And as Yahweh passed his hand by him, David was made to know, you see, how to build and construct Solomon's temple, if you will. You see, but because he was right his eyeball and looking over at that woman, you see, and she was fine, guess what? And they say in the cartoons, he was a murderer. He had that man's or woman's husband killed. Put him in the front line. He'd do anything that the king said. And he served David. And he put him in the front line, knowing he's going to be killed, so he can be with that woman. You see? But David did say this. He said, if I had to have anybody to judge me, let it be Yahweh.
That's right.
I do not want man to judge me, because man have no mercy. You know how we do. We knock you down the door. Starts. Don't be a can off. You know what I mean? That kind of thing. But Yahweh had mercy on David. Mm-hmm. You see? And guess what? He got with James Bathsheba. And here comes Solomon, which was the son. And guess what? Yahweh gave David divine specifications how to construct this temple. But it was his son David. His son Solomon, who built the temple.
That's right.
You see, just like Yahweh the Father, but it was his son that is symbol, you follow me, the creation.
Yeah.
And it was just like Noah, who had three sons. It was Noah, you see, and his sons did the work. You ain't going to read that, but we understand the principle. Do you follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So you got to see that principle coming all the way down.
Yeah.
You see, but it was these sons that is symbol the creation of Yahweh. So, likewise, in principle, in fulfillment, this also had to happen here. So, you got three kings, each reigning 40 years. So, therefore, when Yahshua died, you see, and he gets buried, and he resurrects, you see, he had to tarry, of course, that is, for 40 days, in fulfillment of the 40 of the three kings,
Yeah.
You follow me? The 40 years up here, the conquest of Joshua and Sai, Joshua and Sai down in Canaan, the 40 years in the wilderness, you see, and the 400 years they were down here, and the 40 years that Moses was down here in the land of Egypt. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, yes, sir.
Is it also a fulfillment of the 40 years in the wilderness? I mean, the 40.
Speak in the mic, please.
Is it also in fulfillment? Wasn't it said that the Adam and Eve were in the garden for 40?
I'm getting there.
Oh,
that's where I'm going.
Excuse me.
I got but a few minutes to get this laid down. Now, remember, what I was doing, when Moses, y'all would call Moses up in the mountain, mm-hmm. you see, and I didn't understand this. I thought I did for years. Until it was brought out about a year ago. Exodus 24, 24 and the last verse. There are three trips in the mountain.
Yes.
One, two, three. Mm-hmm. The first trip, Moses was told to tell the children of Israel to gather up around him and speak to him, which he did. But then Yahweh invited Moses up in the mountain to get the tables of stone. But when he invites him up to get the tables of stone, you see, he shows him the 7 days of creation and then Yahweh entered his rest.
Right.
But he shows Moses also how he puts the man in a deep sleep, okay, which is likened to death. The woman being immersed, you follow me, that is in him. You see, and then he draws her out and presents her or his bride, that is to the man Adam. And then you see him up here in perfect peace. Okay? Now, at this particular time, you see Lucifer, not Yahshua, spying out his father's nakedness. He's watching them. You see? And I ain't got time to draw it out. You see? But, as the founder showed us, you see, after he sees, draws the woman out, he sees them in perfect peace, then he turns Moses' attention away, that is, from Adam and Eve,
mm-hmm.
and then he shows them, turns his attention, that is, the building of the tabernacle. And listen, at this particular time, Adam and Eve is in the rest. So Moses, for 33 days, received divine specifications on how to build and construct that tabernacle, that is, for those 33 days.
Mm-hmm.
Now, after 40 days, read it please, we get out of here.
Exodus 24 and 18. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up in the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights.
Now, keep this in mind. Adam and Eve didn't show up until the sixth day, and then they entered to the rest. And then Moses received divine specification how to build and construct this tabernacle. 32:17.
Mm-hmm. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses,
mm-hmm.
there is a noise of war in the camp.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, it is not the noise of them that shout for mastery, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome.
Now we're still in the second trip, y'all. Alright? Let's read, please.
But the noise of them that sing do I hear.
So here's Joshua saying, I hear a noise of the camp. Well, I don't get it. How come Moses didn't hear it? Okay, read please.
And it came to pass as soon as he came nigh unto the camp,
go ahead,
that he saw the calf and the dancing.
So as Moses coming down out of the mountain, mm-hmm. he could not believe these folks was partying like it's 1999 and they done built this golden calf right here. Is it green?
Yeah.
And it came to pass as soon as he came nigh into the camp
green.
That he saw the golden calf and the dancing, and Moses' anger grew high.
Uh-huh.
And he cast the tables out of his hand
uh-huh.
and break them beneath the mount.
So he breaks the table of stone, right? Now, go ahead, read.
And he took the calf which they had made and burned it mm-hmm. in the fire and ground it to powder
uh-huh.
and strewed it upon the water
uh-huh.
and made the children of Israel drink of it.
Okay, that's good enough right there. Now go to 33rd verse. Or 33rd chapter, 3 and 1.
3 and 1.
Uh-huh.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, depart and go up hence, thou and the people which thou hast brought up out of the land of Egypt, unto the land which I swear unto Abraham.
Maybe it's 34 and 1 and 1. Where he tells them to bring up people
and Yahweh said unto Moses, the two tables of stone,
yes,
like unto the first.
Yes.
And I will write unto these stones the words that were in the first table, which thou breakest.
Go ahead.
And be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai,
uh-huh,
and present thyself there to me in the top of the mountain.
So he goes, though, ain't got time now. He gonna go up with his own table of stone into the cloud. And then, remember, Adam and Eve is already in the, it's already in the garden.
Right.
Right.
You see, and for 33 days, Moses received divine specification how to build, construct that tabernacle. So that's the 33 that we're talking about. So now what Yahweh does, he gives Moses a rerun of how the creation come in, you see, by the pattern again, which you're going to read in the second chapter of Genesis. You see, and he sees the man being formed from the dust of the earth, and how Yahweh put the breath of life in him, how he draws the woman out, you follow what I'm saying? And then he shows him the tree of knowledge of good and evil. You see, and that's when Lucifer shows up on the scene as he goes to approach the woman. That is in the third trip. My point I want you to see, that was the 40th day.
Right.
You see, because now here the third trip, he's seeing him for 7 days, that is 40 days. Now here comes Lucifer into the garden, you see, and now he's approaching a woman to deceive the woman. Now, after 40 days, folks, what we say? There gotta be a change, right?
Right.
He have to come down out of that garden. I'm talking about the man, you see, because he was told to be fruitful and multiply. So therefore, Yahweh, you see, deceived the woman. And I mean, she was deceived. You see, she thought that if she partook of the fruit, she'll get wisdom. Wisdom was a part of her makeup, which she did not know and she did not understand. And she was subject to vanity. So therefore, as that bad boy was spying out his Yahweh's nakedness, believe me, he could have approached Adam, but he did not approach Adam. He approached the woman. You see, because it was her who was subject to vanity. And listen, she in turn gave, when she partook of the fruit, she in turn gave it to her husband, and that's what made them come down out of that garden. He was instantaneously died in his consciousness. My point is, for the next 33 days, that's when Moses sees the genealogies and the pedigrees, which is the beginning of that 40-plane chart coming all the way down out of that garden.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but my point is, you see the 33, go ahead and point it over there. 33 and 7 between the two trips make up the 40.
Right.
And then they had to come down up out of that garden.
Right.
My point is, and all I'm saying, when you see that principle of 40, there's got to be a change in some way, shape, or form. So you always look for that. And here, and I'm going to get out, when Adam partook of that fruit, you see, the book says their eyes were opened. That was your second departmental veil, you see, and the flesh, you see, is made manifest. And they were psychologically and spiritually dead. And as the founder said, Adam had a condemned mind. But let's get one thing straight. He still believed he was Yahweh. All right? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want him to stay there.
Oh, you want to stay there?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah. Make it easier.
I will do that going forward.
You just keep your frame there.
Yeah.
I got it.
Well, the 25th of Papa allowed us to hold class this morning, and we hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30, Sunday mornings from 11 to 1. The fourth Sunday of every month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 to 10:45. Just April the 6th and April the 8th, there will be no class here. We're taking a spring break. And all donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lloyd Lawless, and stand for the doxologists. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Still struggling for the B plus, dude. Struggling for it? I thought it would be good. Did you ever look at what you do? Do you ever go back and look at the video? No, you don't. No, man. What was the last time? Yeah, I saw it.
It's all blue. I like blue.
Yeah, that's all I had to do. But now he would have a higher.
I thought they did. That's when
it went up to 25. But first it was only 15.
My brother-in-law, came from Amsterdam. And so they were over there. They were there.